relapsing disease and that this is not a choice, and I'll explain underlying arguments behind the statement and why is it important, and why it is important to recognize obesity as a chronic relapsing disease. Hopefully I'm pressing on the right button.
Yeah,
I am. So these are my disclosures. So I'll start with from where I want to end, which is what are actually the take-home messages that I want most of you to remember by the end of this talk, and hopefully you will agree with me on the context of these messages by the end of the talk if you don't agree already. Obesity is a chronic relapsing disease. It's driven by complex genetic, environmental, and biological interactions. Obesity is not a failed willpower. Obesity is not a choice, and obesity is not a moral issue. And if we treat and prevent obesity, then we reduce the burden on patients, the healthcare system, the wider economy, and the wider society. And in order to treat and prevent obesity, we need to have a system-wide approach that works on both prevention and treatment at the same time, as well as targeting and addressing the underlying causes and drivers of obesity. We know obesity is very prevalent globally, and we know that this prevalence is actually increased globally. So we are actually failing in terms of preventing and reducing the burden of obesity on a global level. And there must be reasons for that. You know, we've been talking about obesity for decades. We've been trying lots of interventions. There are lots of trials in the literature. Lots of politicians talk about obesity, clinicians, dietitians, psychologists, physiotherapists, surgeons, you name it. We're still not achieving any success. And we know for sure that obesity prevalence is increasing because even Santa Claus, there's a lot of obesity over the years. So that's Santa Claus in 1800. Very healthy by 1930. By 1980, definitely became the low obesity. And by 1919, you are really ready to have bariatric surgery. And that just shows the public image of what is actually being okay. Now, there's nothing wrong by having obesity, but we need also to understand that it's not actually a healthy state to be in. So why are we failing? Because we are not treating obesity as a chronic relapsing disease. So what? Why? We don't treat it as a chronic relapsing disease. What's the problem? Well, because if we don't treat it as a chronic relapsing disease, then that means that we are not addressing the underlying causes of the disease, whether it's biological or environmental. And also that means we are not offering effective long-term treatments, and we are focusing on very short-term interventions, trying to achieve rapid short-term weight losses, without providing the appropriate support and the appropriate treatments to achieve long-term maintained weight loss in the vast majority of our patients. So is it disease? Yes, and I think I'll go through a few slides to support the argument for that. According to the American Medical Association, a disease is defined by having an impairment of normal function, by having symptoms and signs, and by causing harm or morbidity. In obesity, there's physical impairment, there's impairment to satiety signaling, and there's also physical impairment, physiological impairment, in terms of inflammation and insulin resistance. Obesity has symptoms and signs, which you are all familiar with, and obesity can cause a long list of morbidities and harms, which I think the last count was 225 different conditions which are related to obesity and can improve with weight loss. So obesity fit that definition very well. And this is an example about the impaired satiety that can occur in people who have obesity. What you see here on your left-hand side, on the x-axis, you see multiple meals with different calorie content, and on the y-axis, you see peptide YY, which is a satiety signal. And at each calorie content, you can see that people who have obesity have lower peptide YY levels compared to people without obesity, regardless of the amount of calories consumed. So they have less satiety hormone. On your right-hand side, on the y-axis, you see a GLP-1 levels, and on the x-axis is the time in minutes following a meal test. People with obesity in the squares and people without obesity in the circles, you can see that the baseline GLP-1 levels before the meal are largely equal. But when they have the meal, you can see very different responses in their GLP-1 levels. So people with obesity have reduced satiety, and even from clinical practice, there is a subgroup of people who we all met in our clinics where hunger is not an issue for them. They can stay for days without eating. The problem is for them is when they start eating, they don't stop. They don't get that satiety and satisfying feeling. And that fits with that type of picture. obesity also follows the same paradigm as the same epidemiological model as infectious diseases. So when you have an infectious disease, you have the agent, which is usually bacteria or a parasite or a virus, like coronavirus, with everybody wearing masks on their faces. And there's the host, which is usually the body, and there's the disease, which is the infection, tuberculosis, for example. In obesity, the agent is food-related and low physical activity, the host is still the body, and the disease is obesity. So it follows exactly the same epidemiological model. And I think the problem with us is that our lack of understanding or true understanding of the nature of the disease and the underlying causes led us to have the wrong treatment. So the simple approach to obesity, that is, you know, just move, eat less and move more, is driven because we know that in people who have obesity, there is sustained positive energy balance, and that's true. There's certainly more energy intake than there is energy expenditure. But the treatment for it is not just to tell people to eat less and move more, because we need to understand the underlying causes and drivers why there is positive energy balance in the first place. At the same time, when we just focus on eat less and move more, we completely ignore the other important part of the pathogenesis of obesity, which is that the body defends its current weight. So the body set point is set at a higher value than normal. So weight loss becomes very difficult to maintain on the long run. And we explain the underlying mechanisms behind that in a few slides later. But this approach of eating less and moving more, although it's trying to address the disease pathogenesis, is actually not understanding the underlying causes. And those underlying causes are many. Yes, we know that the hypothalamus in the brain is the center which balances the signals that comes to the brain from the adipose tissue, from the pancreas, from the gut, and it decides on energy balance. The problem is that this hypothalamus is actually surrounded by many other factors. These factors have been mapped out in the Foresight project, which hopefully most of you have seen before, but if you haven't seen it, you can Google it and find it easily. I think in 2008 or 2007, I think it was 2008, when the British government decided that they want to map out all the factors that are related to obesity, and they want to see how they interact. And that's the map they came up with. As you can see, lots of factors, and lots of arrows between these factors, indicating lots of interactions between these factors. So just by focusing on the hypothalamus here in the middle and saying, this person just needs to eat less and move more, without sorting out any of these factors around it, clearly we are setting this person in the middle for failure. And we're clearly also failing in preventing this increase in obesity prevalence, which is very evident at the moment. Eventually, those factors result in sustained positive energy balance, the difference between energy intake and energy expenditure, which obviously lead to obesity. I also want to highlight one particular aspect, that one of these circles are related to social inequalities. And I think inequalities are really important globally in terms of a driver of obesity. But they don't cause obesity just because of the inequalities itself. They also have underlying biological contributions, which I will show on the next slide. But this is data, for example, from France, where you see on the x-axis different incomes, the highest income towards the right-hand side. And on the y-axis, you see the percentage of population with obesity. And they took it at three time points, 1997, 2006, and 2012. Gray, dark green, and light green. And what you can see that between 1997 and 2012, across all income bands, there's been an increased prevalence in obesity, regardless how rich or how poor you are. But clearly, the impact was far greater in those who are poorer compared to those who are richer. That increase in obesity here is minimal compared to the increase in obesity here. And this is data from Europe, where they compared education levels with obesity prevalence in multiple countries. You can see lots of countries on the x-axis. Low-level education, dark green, medium level, light green, and the gray color is high-level education. And each one of these countries, the prevalence of obesity is lower than those who are highly educated. That doesn't mean if you are highly educated, you'll be thin. But you are more likely to be thin compared to people who are not educated. And these social inequalities work by multiple mechanisms, and there's very much support on the WHO website, which you can read, and you can look into those mechanisms. But starts even from the time of pregnancy. You are going to have the mother which has either excess weight or malnutrition when she gets pregnant. And that sets the baby on a whole pathway of epigenetic changes that lead to obesity and cardiovascular disease. Again, I'll explain some of those in the next few slides. And add to that all the social components that come on the way in terms of lack of food availability, inability to buy the healthier food, etc., inability to breastfeed, etc., all other factors that play into this. So, what about the role of genetics? If you map out all the genome-wide association studies, that took a gene variance related to obesity, and you map it out against the organ. So which organ these genes variants come from? You will see that there is one organ that is very prominent in terms of the number of gene variants affected. And that's it. The central nervous system. So when it comes to the gene variants that actually affect body mass index or fat mass, all these gene variants are very strongly related to the body mass index. All these strongly related to the central nervous system. Which is not surprising considering the hypothalamus is in the brain. And the hypothalamus actually determines our energy homeostasis. While when it looks at body fat distribution, then most of the gene variants related to body fat distribution actually relate to adipocyte function, not to brain function. So our total fat mass is a function of our brains. Our fat distribution seems to be a function of our adipocyte. And Sadat Farooqi lab in Cambridge earlier this year found out a lot of genes that are also related to thinness. So not only that you have gene variants that make you heavier, there are gene variants that actually make you thinner. And the role of genes is not new. This is from 1976. The top row is identical twins. You can exactly see the same body composition between these identical twins. And in this study, where they looked at twins which were brought up together and twins which were adopted and brought up in two different places, they found that the correlation coefficient of the values of BMI in identical twins who were brought up together was 0.7 for men, 0.66 for women. When you look at those who were brought up apart from each other, let me repeat that again. The inter-pair correlation coefficient for BMI for identical twins which were brought up separate from each other, that was 0.7 for men and 0.66 for women. When you look at those who were brought up together in the same house environment, it's not really that much higher. So again, that suggests an important role for the genes, but that's related to BMI. We're not talking here about body fat distribution, we're talking here about BMI. But that also suggests that the role of the genes is very strong in determining people's weight. And in this study, which looked at all the twin studies and adoption studies at the time, that was in 2010, so it's a little bit old, and I'm not aware of any new work that's been repeated in this area. They looked at all the twin studies and adoption studies, and they tried to identify how much of the weight is hereditable during different childhood stages. And if you can see here, by the age of 15, about 70 to 80% of the weight is hereditable. So 70 to 80% is high. If I tell you that height heritability is 85%, you will never call a short person that they have, that it's their fault that they are short. You will never call a tall person that it's their fault that they are tall. Not much about heritability, we are talking about 70% heritability. But we are very happy to call people who have obesity as their own fault. And that's obviously all related to the prejudice and stigma related to obesity. While the environmental factors, which are on the bottom figure, contribute about, by the age of 15 to 18, they contribute about 20 to 30%. Obviously, this figure can vary by study, and this is, we are talking about a population, we are not talking about individuals. So if the individual sitting with you in the clinic, their contribution will vary within a range. It's not exactly 70% for everyone. We also know from this very large study, which was published in Cell last year, which looked at more than 2 million genes variants, that, and then they developed a polygenic score, so the higher the score, the higher gene variance related to obesity the person have. By the age of 18, those in the lowest decile, so these are the people who've got the lowest number of genes related to obesity, are about 15 kilograms lighter than those who've got the highest in the 10th decile, who have the highest number of genes related to obesity. And you can see 15 kilograms by the age of 18, that's hefty, that's quite a lot. And if you look at it longitudinally over the years, you can see that those with decile 1, which are in the blue line, kind of light blue here, their chances of developing severe obesity, defined as a BMI of 40, is close to zero, it's about 1%. So they always have no chance of developing severe obesity if they are in that decile. While in those who are in the 10th decile, who have the highest number of genes related to obesity, their chances of developing a BMI of 40 is about 16%. And there is a dose gradient between the different deciles, in between. Now, what is important to understand about that here we are talking about genes not necessarily controlling the destiny. So we are saying 16% of them will develop a BMI above 40. There's still 84% who did not develop a BMI above 40, despite 25 years follow-up. So what the genes here is making the person far more predisposed to the environmental factors. But it doesn't mean that they will definitely develop obesity. This is not a monogenic disease. I've given you trajectory of weight loss are related to the number of genes. So this is a follow-up study over 6 years where they looked at the factors related to weight changes over a 6 year period, and the genetic score was a negative predictor. So what that means here in this context of study is the lower the genetic score, i.e. the less genes you have related to obesity, the greater the weight loss is over 6 years period. And if you compare those who managed to lose 5% of their weight with those who gained weight over the 6 year follow-up, you can see they have a lower genetic score as well. So again, that suggests that the response to the intervention, whatever that intervention we are doing, are also modified by the actual genetic background of that patient. So those who lose a bit less may not necessarily be just simply non-compliant with the treatment. This is just simply their makeup. So how does the gene and the environment interact? I'm just going to show several examples here, but this is not an exhaustive list because this needs a talk on its own. In this study, the FQO gene is one of the genes related to obesity. And if you have the FQO gene, you behave better than someone else who doesn't have the FQO gene. And that shows it here. These, the group of people who have the FQO gene, these don't have the FQO gene, these are heavier. However, within that, those who have the FQO gene and physically active are lighter than those who have the FQO gene and not physically active. But those who have FQO gene and physically active, they're still a little bit heavier, tiny bit, than those who have FQO gene and not physically active. And obviously the lightest group are those who don't have the gene and they are physically active. So the society and the healthcare and the policymaker and the healthcare professional will look at this person who's physically active, but they are heavier because they have the FQO gene and we call them lazy. But this person who doesn't have the FQO gene and doesn't move, they're not lazy. And that's because of the prejudice we have against the disease. But they also highlight that although the FQO gene will make you heavier, how heavier is a function of the environment. You could be a little bit heavier or a lot heavier. That's where all the other environmental factors, including physical activity, for example, will come in. And I'll show four more examples of that. So this is the change in BMI with increased 10 points in the genetic score. This is physical activity tertiles. This is watching TV hours per week. If your genetic, if the number of genes increase by 10, and I'm making an overgeneralization here, but if your number of genes increase by 10, and you are very physically active, and you don't watch TV, your BMI goes up by about half a point. The same number of genes increases, but you are physically inactive, and you watch a lot of TV, and your BMI goes up by 2.5 points. So while the genes will result in your weight gain, the amount of that weight gain clearly modifies with what else is going on around you. If you look at this food analysis, this is 32 genes looking at gene score development based on 32 genes, and they divide them into quartiles. This is the lowest number of genes, this is the highest number of genes, and this is the response to one sugary drink. So there is modeling in this work. This is what happened to your BMI over 4 years period in response to one sugary drink a day. If you're in quartile 1, you don't gain weight. If you're in quartile 4, you gain weight. So your response to that sugary drink can be modified because of your genetic background. If the person was on a diet, we call this one adherent. We call this one non-compliant, which has nothing to do with it at all. And this is another example, another gene related to obesity, the TCF. I don't know why they find slightly nicer than anything. TCF7L2, they just want to challenge me when I'm presenting. And this was a randomized control trial over 2 years of low-fat versus high-fat diet. And then when they wanted to look at the responses to the diets based on the genetic background, in this case they looked at the TCF7. And what you see here, if you don't have the gene, your response to low-fat and high-fat is exactly the same. If you have that gene variant, then your response to low-fat is far greater in terms of weight loss than your response to high-fat diet. Again, we call this person compliant. We call this person non-compliant. And there's nothing to do with it. Even your response to an advert could be affected by your genetic background. So this is a very nice study where they brought children. So this is children around the age of 10. They randomized them into watching a toy advert over half an hour, so it's a long advert, or a food advert over half an hour. And during the advert, they gave them a buffet, so they can eat what they want. And as you'd expect, people who watched the food advert ate a little bit more than the people who watched the toy advert. But when they look at the response and the interaction with the FTO genotype, you can see those who watched the food advert and didn't have the FTO gene, they actually didn't eat more, despite watching a food advert. Those who had the food advert, but they had the FTO gene, they ate a lot more. So even the response to media, that is not the message here is not saying the media has nothing to do with it, let media show whatever they want. No, that's not true. That's not the point which I'm trying to make. What I'm trying to make here is, although we need to address issues related to the media and contributing to obesity, it's important to know that people's responses has nothing to do with their moral issues or willpower as well. That because this can be actually predicted by their genetic phenotype, genotype. There are more examples I can talk about in terms of interactions between the gene and the environment, but I'll stop there here in terms of this example. But it's very important to understand that although we are saying most of the weight is genetic, and the genes can decide whether you will be heavier than somebody else, the degree of that heaviness is certainly related to environmental factors. And addressing those environmental factors will be an important aspect and part of addressing the obesity epidemic. But also, we can't blame people for being heavier, because this is simply just their genetic makeup. What about maternal program? So these are factors which are related in uterus even before we have any conscious or willpower. This is a study which looked at the mother BMI at the time of pregnancy, and then it divided it into three fertiles. And they looked at waist circumference, body fat, in the offspring at the age of 30. So you can clearly see that women who had heavier BMI at the time of pregnancy, their offspring were also heavier at the age of 30. And the different colors are multipares versus nulliparous, and the relationship is there regardless. And if you look at those, okay, that was just one time point at the age of 30. What about weight change during adulthood? So in this study, they looked at the relationship between the maternal BMI at the time of pregnancy, and they looked at the change in BMI in the offspring between the age of 17 to 32. So that's over 15 years period. The heavier the mother at the time of pregnancy, the greater the weight gain in the offspring between 17 and 32. And if you look at maternal weight gain, i.e. the weight gain that occurred during pregnancy, you see very similar results. And this is independent of baseline BMI. So the greater the woman gained weight during pregnancy, the greater the offspring gained weight during adulthood. And it's not just about weight. We know obesity is about health, not just weight. In this study, they showed that women who had obesity at the time of pregnancy, their offspring had 40% increased chance of death before the age of 55. And that's usually cardiovascular death. So increased risk of cardiovascular death, this is not just about weight, this is about actually the larger health picture. And just to say that, although I presented here data about the mother, not because I don't think the father has any contribution, it's just that's where the data is. There is more data recently suggesting that also father factors related to their weight also play an important role in this. So I need to update my slides a little bit. But nonetheless, most of the data currently, sadly, is about that model. Obesity is also a disease process. We all accept that a blood pressure above a certain point is hypertension. Diabetes above a certain point, glucose levels above a certain point is type 2 diabetes. LDL above a certain level is hypercholesterolemia, and so on. What's the difficulty to understand that this is also the case about weight? Why weight above a certain point is not just an abnormal or a disease? And obesity is a disease process. In the first step of this disease process, there is the expansion of the fat mass before you get anything else. But then you start developing the high-grade inflammation, you start developing the insulin resistance, you start developing the sleep apnea, the ectopic fat deposition, and the disease cascade from there. And it's a spectrum. Some people, we see them in the clinic early in the spectrum. We see some people at the end of the spectrum. But it's a spectrum. And it's a journey that most people will go on, as I will show in a minute, that you might have healthy obesity, but that healthy obesity doesn't last. So we know those who have what is called metabolically healthy obesity, and you have to accept that this definition varies between studies, so sadly there is no consistency. But in this meta-analysis, they have 24% increased risk of mortality. And that's a significant increased risk of death. And that was in people who have just obesity with no complications. This is where from our group, we looked at 3.5 million individuals, we followed them up for just under five and a half years. And we compared normal weight, who have no complications, with those who have obesity, but they have no complications either. So no diabetes, no hyperlipidemia, no hypertension. And we looked at their cardiovascular disease. And what we found is about 50% increase in the risk of coronary heart disease, 96% increased risk of heart failure, 7% increased risk of stroke. How healthy these healthy people are. And actually, are we doing them a favor by saying, you know what, you're fine. You don't have problems, you know, you have excess fat, but that's fine. It's not fine, really. They might not be your immediate priority to treat, but they are certainly an important group to prevent those complications. And this is another word from our group, which is if you compare people who have normal weight and no metabolic abnormalities here with those who are overweight and no metabolic abnormalities, you can see increase in the risk of fatty liver disease over 6 years. And if you compare it with those who have obesity with no medical abnormalities, then you are talking about 7 times increased risk of developing fatty liver disease. And after fatty liver disease, there is increased risk of cardiovascular disease, and there is increased risk of death, and all sorts of other complications, including type 2 diabetes. And if we look at metabolically healthy obesity outside the context of just metabolism, we know obesity not only affects metabolism, there's mental health issues, there's physical issues. So if you look at it in the inventory staging system, you will find that with a BMI above 30, only about 8% here, 5% of class 2, 5% of class 3, actually have an Edmonton score of 0, i.e. they have no metabolic, mental, or physical activity impairments from their obesity. So the proportion of people who fall into that really niche saying that, you know, we can't call it a disease because there are people who are healthy, well, actually this is a small number, a small proportion of people who do not actually stay healthy for a long time. However, the good news is that 5% weight loss is actually easy to achieve. And about 1 in 7 to 8 people in the UK every year lose 5% of their weight. The bad news is that they regain it, 50% of them regain it over 2 years, and by 5 years, 80% of them regain the 5% weight loss. So again, that shows that the weight loss, achieving the weight loss is not that difficult. It's actually very common. The difficulty is maintaining this over the long term periods. And this is from multiple trials, which looked at multiple interventions, and you can see, regardless of the lifestyle intervention done, there is a good success in terms of weight loss. 4 years later, it's done, it's gone. So why does that happen? Well, that's because the body has got that set point in which it defends it. And it's got a higher set point, so it defends its weight at a higher level. In this study, they gave people a very low energy diet. By 10 weeks, they lost a lot of weight, as you can see. And they followed them up for another year, where they regained some of the weight, but not all of it. At the same time, they measured their hunger and satiety, and if you look here, because that's easier to understand, they did mixed meal testing. Before the meal, you are hungry. When you eat, you're not hungry. And then your hunger increases by the time you're ready for your next meal. That was at baseline, before they lost any weight. What happened after 10 weeks, when they lost weight? They still have the same shape, but they're just more hungry at the start, and they are less satisfied and still more hungry during the meal. And what happened after 1 year from stopping the intervention, where weight regain occurred, that hunger is still there. So these people are still hungry after they lost weight. They feel it. And when we measure a lot of neurohormonal signals that can affect their satiety, ghrelin is a hunger hormone. At baseline, this is the level. When they lose the weight, what happened to their ghrelin? It goes up. That's why they are feeling more hungry. With the weight regain, it goes down, but not to baseline level. What happened to peptide YY, a satiety signal? When they lose the weight, the satiety goes down and stays down after the weight regain. And if you measure them postprandially, you get exactly the same result. And it's not just about the changes in appetite and satiety, there's also a change in energy expenditure. When you make people gain weight, they increase their energy expenditure above what you would expect just from the increase in fat mass. And this is an attempt of the body to bring their weight down again.
The same happens when the person loses weight. Their energy expenditure goes down because nobody is trying to push them up again. And this is data from the loser competition in the US, where over 30 weeks, people lost about 60 kilos. That's a lot of weight over 30 weeks. I'd love to lose 60 kilos over 30 weeks. But by 6 years, you can see most of them regained a lot of the weight. But the striking thing was, is the metabolic adaptation, i.e. the energy expenditure is still about 500 calories a day less than what would be expected for their fat mass 6 years later. So despite losing the weight, regaining the weight, their energy expenditure is still in a conservation mode, i.e. their body is still trying to conserve energy to stop them from any weight loss, although they are regaining weight. And that's the difficulty. So what we are seeing here is very successful weight loss at 30 weeks. Not a bad weight loss outcome completely at 6 years, because some people are still lighter, but some people actually are heavier. But the metabolic adaptations are working against them. These people conserving energy. And even when you put them through a very vigorous exercise program, like this one here, this is baseline, 6 weeks, 30 weeks. This is very intensive low energy diet, but combined with very intensive physical activity, you can see that the physical activity increases the non-resting metabolic rate or energy expenditure. But their resting energy expenditure just falls down with the weight loss. And effectively, this exercise did just shrinks with time because people can't cope with that increase in terms of demand. And I'm sure somebody else will talk about it later. So what happens when we lose a lot of weight? There is reduction in satiety signals from the gut, there's increase in ghrelin, there's drop in insulin, the leptin goes down because we are losing fat mass. And all that basically tells your brain that you are more hungry and you really need to eat more. And what do you do then? You just eat more. And at the same time, we have a drop in energy expenditure as part of the metabolic adaptation. The combined effect of that is weight regain. So when we see people regaining weight, it's nothing to do with the fact that they lost their willpower, they're not energized enough, they're not motivated, they're just lazy, whatever you want to call it. It's biology. It's just simply biology. And the reason why lifestyle intervention with pharmacotherapy will work better than either of them alone is because pharmacotherapy addresses some of that pathogenesis. It addresses those satiety signals by improving people's satiety. So it sort of counteracts some of the metabolic adaptations. And that's why bariatric surgery also works. It's because it counteracts those metabolic adaptations. People who are losing weight after gastric bypass, they don't feel increased hunger because they lost weight. They find it actually easy for them to make the right choices because we actually change the neurohormonal mechanisms behind it. It's nothing to do with their willpower. They didn't change. They are the same individual before and after surgery. What changes the mechanism? The biology. So it is important to recognize obesity as a disease. I think it's very important because, one, it will encourage all the stakeholders, government, policymakers, food industry, media, healthcare professionals, patient organizations, built environment, local authorities, everybody, to actually try to work together to address this disease. But also it's important that understanding that these factors are not really just completely under the patient's own control will remove a lot of stigma associated with obesity, and also will empower patients to know that this is just not simply my own doing to myself. And we know many countries, the organization accepted obesity as a disease, and I need to add Italy here. I haven't updated the slide yet, but I will. The Italian flag there, who recently recognized obesity as disease. But it's very important because at the end of the day, obesity stigma is really very common and is really have very bad impact on people. They internalize the stigma and they blame themselves. And it also disrupts their relationship with the healthcare professionals. So it stops people from seeking treatment and engaging with treatment, with interventions. And this is from the All-Party Parliamentary Group survey in 2018. 26% of people with obesity reported being treated with dignity and respect by healthcare professionals when seeking advice or treatment for their obesity. That's just a quarter of the patients felt that they were treated with respect by doctors or any other healthcare professionals when they asked for help about obesity. When you are faced with so much stigma within the healthcare system, there's no surprise that you are not able to treat this disease. So we do need to address this before we actually be able to move forward. So what does it mean to treat obesity as a chronic disease? It means that you understand the causes better, in instead of blaming people for what is actually not their fault. This will reduce the obesity stigma. And that also will stop us setting up the patient for multiple cycles of failure. So every time they fail a diet or a new program, we just said, let's try it again. Well, if it doesn't work, it doesn't work. If they're not from the 20% who respond to lifestyle intervention, you better escalate your treatment. You need to go to the next step. Just trying the same thing again and again is not going to produce any different results. So it hopefully stops us from setting up patients for multiple cycles of failure, and it will help us provide long-term intervention rather than just short-term interventions. Looking at the disease as a chronic relapsing disease over a life course will help us provide long-term treatments rather than just short-term intervention. Obviously, the nature of intervention might change over time. I'm not saying the intervention will be the same over the whole life course, but there need to be support and intervention. And it also helps us improve access to multiple treatment options and implementing a whole system approach where we are looking at prevention and treatment at the same time, and also addressing the underlying causes and drivers of the disease. So to summarize and conclude, it's really time to change the narrative about obesity. Eat less, move more is a very simplistic approach that proved to be a failure in the vast majority of people and just doesn't address any of the biological underlying causes. Recognize obesity as a chronic relapsing disease requiring lifelong treatment and support. Address the underlying biological and environmental causes of obesity. Work on prevention and treatment simultaneously. And at this point, I just find it amazing. Every time I go to a policy meeting, there's this question, should we put the money on prevention or should we put the money on treatment? I just say, when was the last time you asked this question about cancer? Have you ever asked yourself, shall I prevent cancer or treat cancer? You just do both. Why is obesity, do we need to make this decision about should we focus on prevention or treatment? You need both. It's a full bathtub at the moment. Unless you switch the water off and open the exit, this bathtub will remain full forever. And we need to challenge and eliminate obesity stigma, which I think is a real hindrance and has a very negative impact on people. I'll finish with just this one slide related to one study from Israel, which was published recently, showing that adolescents who have obesity have increased risk of cancer by middle age. And this is really just to put it in context, what is the impact of not doing anything about obesity? So I think if we don't act now, we're really feeling a lot of generations. Thank you very much.